各位同事，我睇到嗰个
members， the time is now 2:30 PM。This is the meeting of the Subcommittee on Fugitive Offenders France Order. It's the appointed time, so we will proceed to the election of chairman, Mr. Kent Leung. Any nominations? I nominate you, Mr. James To. All right, so you nominate James To, seconded by Gary Chan. We have no other members. So I'm elected chairman. Now invite the administration in. I'd like to welcome the administration. We have Ms. Iris Lee, Principal Assistant Secretary for Security, Mr. Percy Leung, Assistant Secretary for Security, and from the Department of Justice, we have Ms. Anthea Lee, Deputy Principal Government Counsel, Mr. Felix Ho, Senior Government Counsel, and Ms. Kathy Sito, Senior Government Counsel. Welcome. We now hand over to Ms. Iris Lee. Please brief us on the Fugitive Offenders France Order. And as usual, we would draw comparisons with the model agreement. Thank you. First of all, I'd like to thank members for joining the subcommittee to scrutinize the Fugitive Offenders France Order. I'd like to thank the Assistant Legal Advisor for raising questions and comments. On criminal matters, Hong Kong has been cooperating with various jurisdictions, and according to Article 96 of the Basic Law, we would sign bilateral agreements, and such agreements provide a legal basis for Hong Kong to work with other MLA jurisdictions, and it shows our commitment to combating crime. And the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance provides for statutory frameworks on the surrender of individuals to certain places outside Hong Kong. And surrender of fugitive offenders agreements were signed. Hong Kong has signed SFO agreements with 20 jurisdictions, including the agreement signed with France in May 2017. According to the FOO, the CE in Council has made the Fugitive Offenders France Order, and the FOO provisions would apply to Hong Kong and France. For the agreement signed between Hong Kong and France, it sets out the provisions of the surrender of those convicted or accused, and the relevant offenses must constitute crimes under the respective jurisdictions, and surrender can be rejected under certain circumstances. And after both jurisdictions complete the local legislation, it would only come into effect 30 days after the date on which the contracting parties have notified each other. And the dates of operation of the agreements will depend on when France complete their respective domestic procedures. And I urge members to support the making of the Fugitive Offenders France order for the clause-by-clause comparison, I would defer to my colleagues. First of all, any overall questions? I do not have a lot of context on these fugitive offenders orders. I'd like to know when and who set the model agreement, and is Hong Kong adopting the latest version of the model agreement? I'd like to know more. For the model agreement on the surrender of fugitive offenders, based on our records, it was agreed before 1997, before the 1997 Sino Hong Kong Joint Declaration was made. There is a UN treaty on extradition, and there are certain protections on the surrender of fugitive offenders. And under the Fugitive Offenders Ordinance, CAP 523, the provisions must tally with the model agreement. Some of the provisions are unique to Hong Kong. Generally speaking, for the surrender protections and protections under CAP 503 of the Hong Kong laws, they have all been included in the model agreement. So under the joint declaration, the agreement is unique to Hong Kong. You said you refer to the UN Treaty on Extradition as well. Does it mean that the model agreement does not contradict the UN Convention? Is that the correct understanding? The model agreement only applies to Hong Kong. So in our negotiations on SFO agreements, we would point out that this is Hong Kong's model agreement, and the agreement tallies with the provisions under CAP 503. As for the UN Treaty on Extradition, the provisions are rather brief, and some provisions are optional in nature. For the mandatory provision, we have not compared the provisions one by one, but we have incorporated all the key protections. So as you negotiate with other jurisdictions, other countries might produce their own versions of the agreements. So why would they accept Hong Kong's model agreement? For example, Hong Kong and Denmark both have needs to on the surrender of fugitive offenders. So how would this go about? So where is the starting point? You signed 20 orders. Was the Hong Kong model agreement adopted in all those cases? Or was it taken at the starting point? For the final question, I would have to look up further information. So far, before we started negotiations, we would share our model agreement by mail or email. Very often, other jurisdictions have their own model agreements, and they might wonder why they are to adopt Hong Kong's model agreement. So we do have a trump card. Our model agreement was endorsed by the Central People's Government, and it was agreed under the Sino-British Joint Declaration. So if there are major modifications, the Central People's Government might not endorse the agreement. So we would indicate that we face greater limitations, and very often other jurisdictions would understand. the key is that the provisions and protections are often internationally recognized. The model agreements are different, and some would be unique to Hong Kong and our one country, two systems approach, but there are no major discrepancies. Do you have a list on the countries with which you have signed the orders or fugitive offenders orders? It is at the annex. Legal advisor, can you read out those countries? Please read out those jurisdictions. The Netherlands, Canada, Australia, Malaysia, Philippines, US, Indonesia, India, Singapore, UK, New Zealand, Sri Lanka, Portugal, Finland, Germany, South Korea, Ireland, South Africa, and the Czech Republic, and France. So we have countries from different continents. So in Europe, there are a few countries, the Netherlands, Portugal. I have one more question. Have you discussed this with Taiwan? There was a recent incident involving the surrender of fugitive offenders. Have you discussed this with Taiwan? Did the CPG endorse any negotiations with Taiwan? Apparently, the legal advisor wrote down something. This is rather politically controversial. Well, you should resort to jurisprudence, but not politics. Under Cap 503, there is a provision on the surrender of fugitive offenders, or rather, there is a definition. And only the following provisions would apply. A would apply to Hong Kong government, as well as governments outside of Hong Kong, the Central People's Government, and other, well, the exceptions are the Central People's Government and the governments in the PRC. So is Hong Kong, is Taiwan included? So from the perspective of the People's Republic of China, Taiwan is considered part of the PRC. So under the ordinance, negotiations with Taiwan is not allowed. Is that the government's interpretation? Yes, this is our interpretation. So there is a legal framework. Unless you list Macau, SAR, and Taiwan side by side, and there would be special treatment. All right. Mr. Chen, any questions? Well, I have a question. We have signed orders with 20 countries, including a lot of common law jurisdictions. It has been 20 years and the negotiations are ongoing. You would make negotiations based on the model agreement, and now you are making the France order for other common law and advanced jurisdictions. With so many successful examples already, why aren't you able to sign more orders? Under Cap 503 and Cap 525, the Department of Justice has been working hard in negotiations with other countries. But the progress does not only depend on Hong Kong. It is a process of interaction, and in the past years, we have commenced work, and we are at advanced stages in certain negotiations, but we cannot disclose them at this stage. But nonetheless, work is ongoing, and our goal is to build a comprehensive network with other jurisdictions. My concern is that In recent times, there was a report from the United States requested Hong Kong to surrender an individual, but the request was rejected by Hong Kong, and we explained that apparently that person has committed a crime in mainland China, and as such, he would be surrendered to the mainland, and the U.S. request was rejected.
So I was asking about, you know, what points other members have. So there's this concurrent surrender. So two places concurrently asked for the surrender of the same suspect for crimes committed in different places. So well, it's stated in the U.S. report referring to the case. So when we look at the provisions and the order, would it make it difficult for us? And secondly, well, there are more than 20, right? And then countries, do we need to add a provision in the light of the new order, or so far nobody has made a request? Could you give me a bigger picture on this? Yes, two questions you raised. First, the progress of the bilateral agreements signed. As I said, besides bilateral agreements, there are also other places where, according to 503, we can, on the basis of international conventions, ask for surrender of fugitives. So U.S. made such requests before. So it's not just about, you know, that the progress of the talks on bilateral agreements would actually affect the surrender, progress of surrendering. And if two countries made the same request, well, this could happen, actually, of course. It's possible. Yes. So this is a possible scenario. So it's not something rare. Therefore, we'll just have a discussion on the same basis. As for the rejection of individual requests under Hong Kong law, Chapter 503 stipulates the reasons for rejection and also compulsory rejections. So when we negotiate with individual countries on bilateral agreements, there could be room for adjustments further. So we'll just work according to the laws and the orders in place. So what I was saying is that should we be concerned about, you know, the issues I just raised, say for the, there are other countries that have not reached agreement, or there are other countries other than the 20 countries mentioned that are still in talks. So now with the report of the U.S. insight, so the concurrent request, I know we're going to talk to that. Let's talk about that. That's the new provision. Do you think that does it mean we need to perhaps add more to the order? So, Chairman, I'll try to supplement. Just then, you're talking about the case in the U.S. The Secretary Bureau and the government have done a lot of explanations already because a lot of media have put much attention or pay much attention to it. So, as Ms. Lee said, for every case, we'll follow the agreement and the Chapter 503 on the concurrent request issue. In the U.S. case, it's nothing to do with this order because we are following according to the agreement with the U.S. And use that as the basis for rejection. So that provision, so it doesn't really fall into concurrent request covered by the latest order. Yes. Okay, understood. But people have the impression that it seems like there are two places asking for the fugitive, and therefore, would that actually require us to pay attention to additional issues? The new provision on concurrent request, as you pointed out, is a new one. but it won't change the current status of things. We just feel that to have an explicit provision talking about, say, in U.S., there are different states, right? If the same or different states want the same fugitive offender, then the internal request should have precedent or be given priority over requests from outside the country. Hong Kong is special because we have a one country, two systems model. So there won't be the request within Hong Kong, but we need to deal with the arrangement for surrender of fugitive offenders between Hong Kong and the mainland. Even though one country, two system is an agreement between China and Hong Kong, if there are concurrent requests, we would deal with the arrangement internally, that domestically, that is within China and Hong Kong first. We say that every time, but we still feel that it's better to have an explicit provision in the law. Well, right now, we don't have the agreement with the mainland. So how can we tell others that you are saying that should concurrent requests happen, mainland will be given priority? Because right now it doesn't have the priority. There's no arrangement for priority treatments now. So you're just trying to be very explicit. So if there is the request made, concurrent request made in the future, then China would be given the, would enjoy the priority. It hasn't happened yet, but you're just preparing for the future, a possible scenario in the future. In this case, France already said that within the country, they would do it this way, so there's no need for such an explicit statement or provision. Mr. Leung, I'd like to ask about some basic issue. If we don't have such a formal agreement or written provision, then sometimes I also heard about cases of Hong Kong fugitives who've escaped to the mainland and then ended up being arrested by security officers on the mainland, and Hong Kong police asked for the surrender of the fugitive. So what sort of arrangement is that when that happens? That is, say, for Hong Kong fugitives who have fled to the mainland, we'll ask the Security Bureau in China to help us identify him. So it's arranged on a discretionary basis, but not based on any surrender agreement. But still, so it's like unilateral discretion. So they would hand over the fugitive to us, not so much on the basis of an agreement. But because Hong Kong and China don't have such an agreement, therefore we never hand over any fugitive in Hong Kong to the mainland. Well, 20 countries have signed such order. So since 1997, how many cases have there been? That is of fugitives surrendered on the basis of these orders of the 20 countries so far. Just give us an estimate, approximate number, please. How many hundreds of cases? What we know is that over the past 10 years, with other jurisdictions with which we have an order, we have made 24 requests, and other jurisdictions made 66 requests to Hong Kong. 66 requests to Hong Kong. So based on such requests, other jurisdictions handed over 11 people to Hong Kong and rejected 4 applications. And Hong Kong surrendered 23 people to offenders to other jurisdictions and rejected 5 requests. So I was just asking to see, you know, Hong Kong signed lots of agreements, you know, with different countries. So if you just leave it aside and don't exercise your right under the agreement, I think that's pointless. So I think it's okay with the information that you've given me. Thank you. Okay, just for background information, one more question from me. Of the 66 cases you mentioned, we surrendered 23, 5 were rejected. So what happened to the rest? Because of the 66 requests received, whether that person really were in Hong Kong, we were not sure. They could make the request to us, but we may not be sure that a person was really here. They may just make the request on the basis of intelligence gathered. Yes, they'll just make a booking, right? Okay, I see the point. Okay, no more questions then. All right, so enough background information. So now maybe let's go to the text. Can you guide us through the paper 474? Just take us through it, please. Comparing it with the model agreement, please. Yeah, I think from the title actually is the same as the model agreement. But France started based on the laws, they want to use the word arrested or convicted, accused or convicted persons in the title. Therefore, it's now the use of accused or convicted persons used in the title instead of fugitives. So again, yeah, the words, you can take note of the use of the words there. Article 1, we always said that the crux of the agreement is the surrendering as requested. So both parties would agree to surrender to each other whoever is wanted by the requesting party for prosecution for the imposition or enforcement of a sentence in respect of an offence. So both parties would have the obligation to surrender. You said that there is an alternative approach. What do you mean by that? That is in Article 2 about offence. Because in Article 1, it talks about that the persons wanted will be for wanted by the requesting party for prosecution or for the imposition or enforcement of a sentence in respect of an offence as provided in Article 2. So Article 2 covers what you called the alternative approach in relation to offences. Most orders would list out the offences. So as mentioned by the chairman, you can see that when we know our progress of negotiation with other jurisdictions have slowed, it's because in many countries, particularly in the Europe, where the continental law is practiced, they feel that the civil law is practiced. They feel that it may not be in conformity with their usual practice. So therefore, since the Czech court order was signed last time, we in our negotiations on the order, we gave the other party a choice. If they find the listing is difficult, we will give them the alternative approach of after signing the order, exchanging information on the offences that for which an offence can be granted. That is, during our negotiations, we will ask them about the offences. Well, basically, they said that they would just cover any criminal offences that carry a jail term of 1 year or above. That's the case in the Czech Republic. But later on, when we exchange the information, if we give them the list of the schedule in Chap 503, the 46 offences, I don't know whether they take a look at the offence, but sometimes they would come back to us and would provide us with their own list.
The main challenge is that their parliaments must pass the relevant agreements. Sometimes the offences are not listed, and they are often the offences are often provided afterwards for the Parliament's approval. You said eventually they provide you with lists. If a Hong Kong person visits France and commits a certain offence, so that person might be surrendered if he or she committed or not committed certain offences. With the case of the Czech Republic, we asked France to provide this list, and in the future, we hope that the subcommittee can see this list, but at the end, their laws would apply. And point one under Article 2 says surrender can be effected, and Hong Kong would submit the 46 offences under Cap 503 Annex 1, while for the other jurisdictions, it would depend on their list of offences. Do you see the point? Where does the list appear? For the France order, the DOJ just received some materials from France, but since we have to carry out translation as well as comparison, the information would be shared later with the subcommittee. With the Czech Republic, when the order was commenced, it was published on Gazette. So when the legal brief was issued, we attached the relevant information for public reference. What was the notice? Did you mean Gazette? At the commencement date, it would be attached in the legal brief. Most users would go online to obtain the information. The DOJ has a dedicated team to edit laws online. So if I search online, then I would see this list or table. Under the DOJ's International Division, well, you can consider adding it to e-legislation, even though it's not part of the laws. Do you know what I mean? Users would not look up papers related to this subcommittee, or that a document is attached to a certain notice. If there's a dedicated team under the DOJ governing e-legislation, can you indicate that the paper has been submitted to the subcommittee and attached to the notice, then they could be read together? If not, people would know about its existence. We would look into the issue. Please provide the translated text. And number two, please indicate how those who are in touch with this law would know about it. Under Article 2 offenses, they list all extraditable offenses. And according to the article-by-article comparison, the approach on extraditable offences has been covered. And the first provision is that these must be offences punishable by imprisonment for more than 1 year under the laws of both parties, and more than 20 offences have been listed. And for the France order, those 20 offences are removed, and we maintain two provisions, and that is the requirement for the offence to be punishable by imprisonment for more than 1 year under the laws of both parties, and number two, the surrender is agreed by both sides. And paragraph 3 would further elaborate on that. Paragraph 2 of Article 2 is essentially the same as that of the model text. If the remaining jail term is half a year or less, this would not be dealt with by this agreement. The idea is to enhance efficiency. Paragraph 3 is new. Both sides must exchange information in terms of the offenses in respect of which a person may be surrendered, and the date of provision of information cannot be later than the commencement of the order. Paragraph 4 is about the double criminality requirement. So the acts or omissions must be considered in their totality. This is about the double criminality principle. Paragraph 5 is new. We are looking at Article 3, right? As always, the more examples, the easier we understand the provisions. We are dealing with nationality, and according to 3.1, are you on Article 2? 2.5, right? Please continue. For Article 2.5, this is a new provision. There were no precedents, and that is if the provisions do not tally with paragraphs 1 and 2, the relevant person can be surrendered to the requesting party. This is in line with the French laws as well as the European Extradition Convention. The principle is accessory extradition. We are dealing with offenses with a jail term of 1 year or more, or offenses on our list. For jail terms of half a year or less, if France can surrender a person to Hong Kong, but Hong Kong has indicated that this is not possible from our side, so the surrender can only go from France to Hong Kong. So long as the offense does not fall under the list, we would not surrender anyone to France, and they understand this point. Hopefully one day they hope our laws would change, which would allow for mutual surrender. So to some extent, we have greater restrictions, so they are offering us some room to operate. So that would not jeopardize the signing of the order, and they realized that we could not do it. Article 3 is about the surrender of nationals. Our model agreement is rather short. Hong Kong reserves the right to reject the rights of Chinese nationals, whereas for the France agreement, paragraph 1 is substantially same as the model text, and that is the Hong Kong reserves the right to refuse the surrender of Chinese nationals, while France reserves the right to reject the surrender of French nationals. And paragraph 2 is about the determination of nationality, and it is determined at the time of the offense. And according to paragraph 3, if a surrender is rejected, the requesting party can ask the requested party to pass on the relevant information to the prosecutors of the requesting party. For some cases, some individuals involve multiple nationalities. For the extraditing party and extradited party, can the rights of the extraditing parties be reserved? After the offenses, a person might adopt another nationality. For example, if France reserves the right not to surrender French nationals, but after the offense, if a person only becomes a French national after the offense, then such right would be reserved. What about the cases of double nationalities? How would they be dealt with? We had no such examples in our experience. I think the requested party would determine the nationality of the fugitive offender. If this provision is invoked, they must offer details of the relevant national. Of course, there is a negotiation mechanism, as we imagine. I believe at the end, the requested party would make a decision. Let's say if a French person is both Chinese and French in nationality, if he holds a French passport and enter China on a visa, and France would say they are extraditing that person, and China said this person is a Chinese national. You accept that that person enters China as a French national with French passport, and you issued him with a visa. So you accepted that a French national entered China. So how can you refuse the surrender of a Chinese national? That is what I think. So how are you going to deal with such cases? Have you had such experience? The nationality at the time of committing the offense would be considered. This is Hong Kong. I would accept some whatever passports as I deem fit. If you are a Japanese, I would consider you a Japanese. For example, if you are a French national, I would consider you French, and I would stamp on your passport. If Hong Kong says this is a Chinese national, for example, if Hong Kong deems that that person is at foremost a Chinese national, that's what the Ministry of Foreign Affairs would say. So I would accept a person visiting Hong Kong on a French passport, and he would be considered a French national. So is there anything we have to get around in this case? It depends on the actual case, but we would look at the nationality at the time of committing the offense. If the offense is committed after entering Hong Kong, and for a person holding a visa, we might have to confirm with the Immigration Department how that person entered Hong Kong. And as I know, the passport is a travel document. It might show the nationality, but whether it is the ultimate proof of nationality, we might have to consider other evidence before we can confirm the nationality. If Hong Kong is to reject requests based on this, we might need to show additional information. We cannot just tell France that we consider that person a Chinese national. We must provide all the relevant information. Perhaps I asked the wrong question. It was the we have to consider that the time of offense, right?
So maybe Mauritius, he killed someone, or in France, when he entered France, he killed someone. At that time of the killing, he may have entered France using a Chinese passport. So that means at the time of the offense, he was a Chinese national. Well, that's too complicated. But no matter what, so France would look at the nationality at the time of the offense and not when someone entered Hong Kong. Okay, that's clear. Can you clarify Article 3? The last time the State Department's report, the case cited there, did we use this clause to reject the application for surrendering? Is it because that person is dual nationality? Is it because of the nationality issue? That's why we rejected the application from US? Yeah. So the US saying that we rejected, that's the fact, right? We rejected the request, and you say it's nothing to do with the concurrent request, but is it based on Article 3 here? When we rejected some country's request, I wouldn't make public the reason, but we would make it known to, we did make it known to the US, so you can't review it here yet. Okay, Chairman was asking if someone, say when he committed the offense, he had three passports, Chinese, US, UK passports, for example. When we decide to whether someone is a Chinese national, whether it can be dealt with by the decided by the Security Bureau, or do you need to seek help from the Foreign Ministry of China? Well, I don't have the information of hand, but we need to act according to Hong Kong laws, because passports may be only used as travel documents. There are all kinds of possibilities, so we need to judge it on a case-by-case basis. So we need to confirm that we have the right basis to for identifying the person's identity, whether he's a Chinese national. Okay, look at it from another perspective then. I do need to ask this question. Say someone had several nationalities at the time of committing an offense. Under the Chinese nationality law, if we feel that someone is a Chinese national, unless he's lost his Chinese nationality, otherwise he's still a Chinese national, right? Is that a presumption that we should start with? According to the Chinese nationality law, they wouldn't allow dual nationality. But as I mentioned, everyone's situation could be different. So you need to look at whether someone has lived overseas or has lost his nationality. So you need to make reference to the Chinese nationality law to see whether that person is really classified as a Chinese national. That's step one. And if it's confirmed that he's a Chinese national, then you could exercise the right under the law, the right to reject a request. Yes. So, well, how about the 20 other orders signed or future orders signed? Would they have the same? They would not have the provision of 3.2 stipulating the nationality of someone when an offense was committed. So, what is the provision used or the criterion used for the other 20 orders? Is it for, I think Article 3.2 also appear in the orders with Singapore, the Philippines, South Korea, and so forth. But how about such provision is for others without this section, saying that nationality to be determined at the time of the commission of the offense? Do you understand my question? It's okay. I know my question wouldn't affect our scrutiny of this France order, but if you can, if you know the answer, please let us know, because at least we know. the basis, and also in the future, say when we have similar discussions with you, we have a better understanding of the background. I'm sure you have a stance on this. You wouldn't just make impromptu decisions in the future. Let's continue with the scrutiny. Article 3.3. 3.3 is done. Article 4, death penalty. That is similar to the model, the same as the model agreement. There are just some changes in words. That if the offence for which surrender person is requested under this agreement is punishable according to the law, the requesting party with the death penalty, and if in respect of such offence the death penalty is not provided for by law or is not long carried out, surrender may be refused unless the requesting party gives such assurances that the requested party considers sufficient that this penalty will not be imposed or imposed. And if imposed, will not be carried out. Article 5.1. Saying that if the offence for which rent is requested is a political offence or one connected with a political offence, then say if Hong Kong is the requested party, then Hong Kong would request it, will reject it. But on the grounds for the rejection, we make an exception. That is, there are two scenarios of exceptions. Is even though it appears to be a political offence, if it involves the taking or attempted taking of the life of the head of state of People's Republic of China, or in the case of the French Republic, the head of state, or in the other case, a member of the head of state's family. Another scenario is one in which is about any offence which, by reason of a multilateral international agreement, both parties must not treat as a political offence or an offence connected with a political offence. So these two clauses here, listed here. So some examples. Multilateral, bilateral agreements. Can you give me some examples? For multilateral agreements, for example, say there's a UN Anti-Corruption Convention, Article 43, which states that under the Anti-Corruption Convention, Article 44, offence listed under the convention, signatories to the convention were not supposed to treat those offences as political offences. Suppression of Terrorist Financing Convention, is another example. Article 14 states that under that convention, offences stipulated by it should not be treated as political offences. And also 1988 UN Drug Trafficking and Manufacturing Convention, Article 10 under it, has similar provision. Okay, that's enough to give us some examples of the agreements. Okay, please go on. B, 1B, B and C are interrelated. That is, the request for surrender, though purporting to be made on account of an offence which surrender may be granted, is in fact made for the purpose of prosecution or punishment on account of race, religion, sex, nationality, or political opinions. Or that person might, if returned, be prejudiced at that person's trial or punished, detained, or disadvantaged by reason of race, religion, sex, nationality, or political opinions. So it's similar to the reasons for compulsory rejection listed under Article Chapter 503. The only difference with the model agreement is we added sex here at the request of France. Okay. By sex, do you mean male and female? But does it include the LGBT community? For example, LGBT, yes. In reference to them, we use the word sexuality, but that's different from sex. Well, this is very specific wording. We consulted the human rights unit in the DFJ, and they told us that sexuality, the word, they're not totally sure of the definition. We check, look it up in the Oxford Dictionary, and so sexuality can include sex and sexual orientation, but now we are only focusing on sexual orientation. So we come to the conclusion that sex, this word, as when we agree with France, we agree that this would not, the word itself would not cover, go beyond the protection, would not go beyond the protection offered by the sex discrimination ordinance in Hong Kong. So you and France know clearly what this provision says. So it does not have a very broad definition. It doesn't cover sexual orientation here. Okay, 2 points. In Chinese, the Chinese word doesn't include the sexual orientation. And of the 20 orders signed, only the order signed with Ireland, AF 503, mentioned sex and sexual orientation. That's the only order with those words. That's the order with Ireland. And South Africa, they used gender in the order, yes, with it. South Africa? Did you mean South Korea? So South Africa is not among the 20 orders. Do you have the order for Australia, Finland? It's not listed in the comparison with the model agreement. So you're saying that sex, the word used here, use a narrow definition of basically gender, male and female, as noted or implicated in or implied in the Chinese version. Fine. Okay, section 2. Another ground for compulsory rejection, that is if, or refusal, that is if the person has been found acquitted or convicted or pardoned for the same offense by the requested party. So this is a common ground of refusal, and same as what's in the model agreement. Please go on. Section 3. Lapse of time. Surrender shall not be granted when the persecution or the punishment for the offence which surrender is requested will be barred by reasons relating to lapse of time. This is actually a reflection of the law in France. Section 3. And it's consistent with our law, and there are precedents of such provision in other agreements. Lapse of time for fraud, offense of fraud. Are you looking at lapse of time in Hong Kong or France? Because if someone committed the fraud in Hong Kong, and the lapse of time in Hong Kong is 10, whereas in France is 12. Hong Kong don't have the lapse of time. Oh, sorry, I was wrong. So I think there are some offenses for which there is a lapse of time. So, yeah. So it depends on whichever has expired. Or say if it's a period of 10 years, would you calculate on the basis of Hong Kong time or French time? Would you look at the time lag? Or include the time lag? I think for deliberate evasion of tax, the lapse of time is 10 years. But for criminal offenses related to taxation, is that covered by this order? Because sometimes taxation offenses are dealt with separately. I know there's a lapse of time of 10 years for tax evasion, but in France, it could be a period of 15 years.
The first question for tax-related crimes, are they included to the list? Yes. You said there is no time limit on the offenses, and according to Mr. Leung's understanding, there is a time limit for offenses in Hong Kong for tax evasion. Perhaps I misunderstood it. Under the Inland Revenue Ordinance, there's a 10-year limit on reassessing the taxes. So if there's no time limit in Hong Kong, while the lapse of time in France will be 20 years, so 20 years will be adopted. Chairman, paragraph 3 talked about surrender offense for which surrender is requested would be barred by reasons relating to lapse of time under the law of either party. So if our time limit is 10 years, then 10 years would be adopted. All right. I have a technical question. If France asks us to surrender a person to France for trial, the offense was committed in France. If the offense is fraud and the time limit for prosecution in France is 20 years, it's only 18 years, so France asks for surrender. So for the same offense, if there is a time limit of prosecution, time limit of 10 years, then can we reject the surrender request since the time limit for prosecution has lapsed? All right. Paragraph 4 is about offenses under military law, and the such offenses would be a mandatory ground of refusal. If the surrender of a person is requested for the purpose of carrying out a sentence, but if it appears that the conviction was obtained in his absence, according to the agreement, the surrender request would be refused unless the person has the opportunity to have his case retried in his presence. This is same as our model text. If there is guarantee that the person can be retried, then we can provide an exception. Article 6. According to the model text, refusal is mandatory, and there are no exceptions. If a person has a chance to be retried, in other words, not a case of being sentenced, and the person is treated as an accused person. Article 6, that's discretionary grounds of refusal. And this is not included in Cap 503. Paragraph 1A says, if the offense was committed fully or partly in the place where the requested party's law applies, the surrender may be refused by the requested party. Should this read, if the requested party can conduct a trial? So the wording is rather lacking. And there is a lot of extraterritorial jurisdiction. So our original model text might include the extraterritorial jurisdiction of France. The scope might be too big under the civil law system, so we would limit the scope to France. So you have to negotiate with each party its scope of jurisdiction. There are jurisdictions who might not be in the same condition as Hong Kong. So let me put it this way, they would be more concerned than Hong Kong about this. For the extraterritorial jurisdiction, if the scope is narrowed, it has limited effect on Hong Kong. There are not many cases in which we can exercise extraterritorial jurisdiction. So for an offense in France, if France requests surrender of fugitive offenders, and our scope would be cases occurring within our jurisdiction. So both our scope and theirs are limited. France has limited the scope for certain corruption cases, for example, French persons in Africa who has come to Hong Kong. If the committal of France is in Africa, for example, in the Central African Republic, and that French national is hiding in Hong Kong, according to this article, you cannot agree to the surrender. Or let me put it this way. If Hong Kong requests surrender, well, we are talking about a French national committing corruption in Africa. So this is the principle of double jeopardy. According to Article 2.1, well, a French national has committed bribery in Africa. The French government says that a person has bribed the government officials in Africa, and that this act is against the anti-corruption laws in France, and the alleged person has fled to Hong Kong. In that case, you can ignore France's request. They can, and equally, they cannot request Hong Kong to surrender the offender. This is in accordance with Article 1A, assuming the case occurs in Hong Kong, and that is a Hong Kong person committing bribery in Africa. So even for cases of bribery, the treatments would be mirrored. So if a Hong Kong person commits bribery in Africa, is it illegal? We would consider whether they are of the same nature. So this is the principle of double jeopardy. Well, I certainly learned something. If Hong Kong requests surrender and France cannot refuse the request under 6.1A. Mr. Kwok, we are at Article 6 in the article by article comparison. We are at Article 6, Paragraph 1B. If the surrender might place the party in breach of its obligations under an international convention applicable to that party. Even though this is not present in the model text, there were a lot of precedents, so we accepted this provision. It wasn't requested by us, right? Well, both parties agreed to it. So why would there be a provision like that? All right, never mind. It is rather hard to imagine. One example, non-refoulement or torture claims. So the model text did not consider this idea. So are the torture claims included elsewhere? These are very basic human rights protections for political fugitives. So perhaps, well, the protection is under Cap 503. That won't be an issue because for torture claims, we cannot surrender the offenders. So this is not allowed by local laws. Then we won't be talking about international agreements. There should be other better examples, right? All right, never mind. If you think of any other example, you can provide it after the meeting so that we can learn something. So for torture claims, that would not be needed because it's covered by another provision. So C, in the circumstances of the case, if the surrender would be likely to entail exceptionally serious consequences related to age or health of the person sought, we have seen a lot of precedents. And in those cases, surrender may be refused. Paragraph 2. This is a relatively new provision. And it is not present in most FOOs or FOO agreements. Surrender may also be refused if the case of a request to the government of Hong Kong SAR, the surrender would significantly affect the interests of the People's Republic of China in matters of defense or foreign affairs. We have had a number of precedents on national defense issues. We agreed to add this provision for better clarity because under Cap 503, Section 3, brackets 4, the chief executive can refuse a surrender. For cases especially relating to the People's Republic of China, it is not a state, it is not a contract party, and France agreed to it. Mr. Kwok. How many times have this reason been invoked in refusing surrender of a fugitive or criminal? Were there any refusals in the past 10 years? There were five refusals. We would have to check the records. I don't have the figures on hand, but I believe there weren't many. Can you provide an answer in writing? I'd like to know how many times in which, well, there were only five refusals in the last 10 years. Of the five refusals, we are talking about Cap 503, Section 24, Bracket 3. So there were only five refusals in total. So Mr. Kwok wants to see figures on the number of times in which refusals were made based on this provision. I'd like to ask about Article 6, Paragraph 2. You said this provision is not present in some of the agreements. So for the more recently signed agreements, this provision is present. You also said that for Cap 503, Section 24, Brackets 3, the provision is present. So even without this provision in the agreement, you can still refuse based on Section 24, brackets 3 of the ordinance. This is what is stipulated under Section 24.3. So do they know about the agreements or provisions under CAP 503? They would know about it because France mentioned that this does not have to be mentioned because this is being done in France. For Hong Kong, we would explain that there are two stages to the surrender of fugitives. Stage one is the court, and stage two, the executive stage involving the chief executive. And the chief executive can consider many other factors in deciding whether or not to surrender the fugitives.
Okay, procedure-wise, say if there is a request for surrender, would you every time ask the chief executive whether she wants or he wants to use exercise discretion? Is it a routine that you do, or would you only ask the chief executive for discretion in exceptional cases only? Well, this is necessary procedure. After the court issued the order for the arrest of a fugitive, a pending decision by the chief executive, the next stage will be for the chief executive to consider the whole case, whether the surrender should be granted. The DFJ has a dedicated division because of possibly conflict of interest. The chief executive, when asked to decide whether to grant the surrender, will ask the second separate unit to decide. We have the judicial unit representing the requesting party to apply to the court for arrest. But when a case is put before the chief executive, the judicial unit would have conflict of interest. Therefore, the case will be handed over to the next division. Together with the secretary bureau, we'll ask the chief executive to make a decision. So the chief executive and in council, would it be that the chief executive would not need to provide any written or verbal reasoning for her or his decision? I'll ask Ms. Lee to answer, because our judicial aid group would have nothing to do with that. Yes, after the court proceedings are finished, the information will be referred to the chief executive for her or him to sign the surrender order. Under Chapter 503, Section 13, there is a provision stipulating the circumstances under which the chief executive can refuse to issue the surrender order. So the chief executive would need to make a decision. It's her or his decision, not together with the council, executive council. But will he or she give a written or verbal reason for her or his decision? So should the chief executive refuse to sign the surrender order, is the written answer be given? If there were any refusals of the request, we will explain to the requesting party. Well, so my question is, next question, reciprocally, France, I don't know whether it's the president or prime minister, whoever is responsible, does he have the same discretionary power? Yeah, according to the provisions, yes, they do. And France also indicated that it doesn't need to be written out because this is in line with international norms for the head of state to have discretionary power. Just then, Kenneth Leung's question is that when the chief executive refused to surrender a fugitive, and the reason is, for example, because of diplomatic reason or national defense, or is mentioned in 2A, or reason listed in 2A, will he or she give a written reply to the DFJ, or will the chief executive just refuse to sign off on the order and then give you the decision verbally only? Refusing to grant the request because of defense, national defense, or diplomatic reasons. Well, this is related to our internal administrative procedure, but we'll provide all the information to the chief executive, and then we'll act according to the instruction of the CE and then explain to the requesting party. But I think legally speaking, procedure-wise, when the chief executive refuses the surrender request, does she or he need to give you a written answer? Well, just looking at Chapter 503 itself, it doesn't state very clearly how the instruction should be given. So it can be verbal. In the past, well, Mr. Kwok asked the question, and maybe you can look into it and see what and find out the answer for us. And let us know the answer in due course. We just want the right answer. Okay, is that fine with you, Mr. Kwok? Yeah, because it's so, you know, these scenarios are rare in the past, and so you may not know very well exactly what happened in each case. We're just worried that should the case arise, what are the procedures that need to be followed and where there needs to be a written reply. And the reason must be given, right? You shouldn't guess the reasons used by the chief executive. So the CE must have a way to tell you his or her decision. And then the DFJ would act according to the reason given by the CE, say informing France about the refusal. So Chairman, let me try to give you a broad answer. My understanding is that if the chief executive wants to grant a surrender, there's a prescribed form. If she refuses the request for surrender, my understanding is even though our judicial mutual aid division has no role to play, but my understanding is that she or he will write down her refusal for the to the surrender request. Just then, Ms. Lisa will inform the requesting party, and that's when we will be aware of a decision. And I'm sure the relevant provisions in the order will be cited. I think that should be the steps followed. But we haven't seen many precedents. So, okay, just give us a written reply on the procedures expected. Okay, please move on. Paragraph 3, that is, if the fugitive in a third party, in a third place, was convicted or is serving sentence in a third country, then the requested party can refuse the request. This is put under the discretionary power, such as because it involves the third party and not Hong Kong and France. We have seen precedents in this case. Sorry, legal advisor. I understand that the grounds for refusal, that is when the third party, the person involved is acquitted or convicted in the third country. And there's also this provision on pardon. Do you think that it's really necessary to have the word pardon, or do you need to have it? I've noticed that in New Zealand, in the New Zealand order, the word pardon is used. Article 5, paragraph 2. For the discretionary grounds of refusal, the word pardon is not used because the reasons for discretions are more flexible. So that's why we didn't include the word pardon, and it's not asked for by the other party. I find that this provision could be used in a strange way, because if I ask you for a person, you said that, well, this person for the same offense has been convicted in a third party. So pretty strange. Then why would that person have been tried elsewhere? Unless it's in a different or a related jurisdiction. But if you say that, well, the person was already tried for stealing chocolates, for example, in Mauritius, So the person, if the person is acquitted, and you think that you have sufficient evidence, and yet, in the third party, the person was acquitted in the lack of evidence, and the third party didn't get try to get more evidence from you. Well, of course, I cannot say anything if all parties agree, but I find that there's some element of uncertainty here because one party may complain, you know, because it's about discretion. If I can convince you that, well, the trial was not properly held in the third party, you may persuade the other person or the other party to have a retrial. Oh, anyway, please continue. On the word pardon, not found here in Article 6, maybe I think no longer enforceable could be part of the reason. Paragraph 4, if the person surrender may be refused, the person sought is being proceeded against the accused party in respect of the offense of offenses for which surrender is requested. So everyone is basically investigating that person. Colleagues, I have a suggestion. We have quite a lot of provisions to look at because now we have a new provision, I suppose, which you I think you have been most interested in discussing. Why should I choose to want to jump to that now, having finished Article 6? Because I'm worried that because then we will at most have one more meeting. But I think in the next half hours, if we have any questions, we can concentrate on asking the administration and then get all the answers at the next time. If we ask you the next time, then we may have to call another meeting, and that will take much more time. So the provision in question is legal advisor. Can you brief us? Let's jump to that controversial part first. Yes, it's Article 13, Paragraph 3, and this is about concurrent requests. Concurrent requests. Paragraph 3, it says that for the Hong Kong SAR, Article 13, Paragraph 1, mentions the circumstances to be considered if both countries want the same person, offender. So in the future, well, it could be China and France asking for the surrender of the same person. So now we've just finished Article 6. I suggest that we now jump to Article 13 and look at it alone. And if we still have time, we can go back to Article 7. If not, then at least I think, because it's a new provision, and for the other 20 other orders, that this provision is not there, and we didn't discuss it in the scrutiny of the previous order. So let's spend more time on Article 13. I think the administration will not object, right? Because we still continue with the scrutiny. Now let's go now to Article 13. So the administration first. Yes, as the legal advisor just said, this article is about concurrent requests. That is, if there's more than one request for surrender of the same person, paragraph 1 says that for the more than one request for surrender for the same person, what should happen is that the most should be considered, that is all the circumstances should be considered, including the arrangements for the surrender and the seriousness of the offense and the place of commission of the offenses, the respective dates of the request, the nationality and ordinary place of residence of the person, and the possibility of subsequent surrender to another place. So these circumstances are the same as those in the model text and also in all other orders. Paragraph 2, it says that in the event of surrender of the person to that third state, Well, as long as it's not France or Hong Kong, then the requested party should notify the other party of its decision with reasons. So this is a general provision, and it's found in all orders as well. So the new provision is here, section 3, paragraph 3. That is, for the Hong Kong SAR, the provisions of this article shall not affect the arrangements for the surrender of accused or convicted persons between the Hong Kong SAR and any other part of the People's Republic of China. So it states very clearly here the arrangement for the surrender between Hong Kong and China and other places. So this is nothing to do with administrative arrangements or, as Ms. Lee, RSD just said, deportation or extradition of offenders back to Hong Kong. This is about arrangement for surrender of a fugitive.
The purpose of introducing this provision is that we have negotiations with the mainland in mind on the surrender of fugitive offenders. We felt the need to expressly provide for it, because unlike France, initially France said they would deal with requests within the nation, but for us France can decide what to do within its territory, but for Hong Kong, due to one country, two systems, China is not a contract party, so that's why we want to clarify the issue. Like other agreements, even if we do not provide for it, the surrender of fugitive offenders within one country would not be affected. I'd like to know about the definition of France. As you know, France has overseas dependent territories. Within France, they said they would give priority to the dealing with fugitive offenders. So how do you define the country of France? Would the overseas dependent territories be considered part of France? Let's say if an island who is a dependent overseas territory, if they request a surrender, would Hong Kong surrender the fugitive to that island? As we understand, the definition of France does not include its dependent territories. Please consider this carefully. Should the Ministry of Foreign Affairs tell us what their recognition of France means, so that this is where the usual definition, please provide it in writing. For the Netherlands, we would specify the territorial application. For example, if we are to sign agreements with Japan at Diaoyu Islands, there would be controversy of whether it is part of China or Japan. So in France, it might be more straightforward because there are no territorial disputes. But for India, there might be similar problems. So please consider this carefully. Mr. Kwok, for Article 3, Paragraph 3, you assume that if there are surrender arrangements with the mainland, they would override the fugitive offenders orders signed with other countries. So what is the basis of that? We are talking about mutual surrender of fugitive offenders between jurisdictions. So would this, if there is a SFO agreement with the mainland, would it necessarily override the agreements with other jurisdictions? I'd like to hear about the basis or jurisprudence. If this is an agreement signed with the US or France for a U.S. order, as I said, if Washington wants someone from New York, that happens within a country, but they are within the same jurisdiction. We are talking about different jurisdictions. Under one country, two systems, mainland China and Hong Kong are different jurisdictions. In other aspects of law, that is our perspective. We are talking about two separate jurisdictions. So why would the mainland China agreement take precedence? Thank you, Chairman. In page one of the order, that is the commencement date and how the chief executive in council made this order. Article 2 says that for the agreement signed with France, it would apply
in the terms of the arrangements. 咁我嘅理解就係 freedom of contract 啦，兩方可以即係。So
as I understand, this is free of the contract, and both sides can agree to limitations. And this was carried in other provisions. I do not agree with the priorities. You assume that the mainland, the agreement with the mainland would take priority. There must be a reason. You talked about the U.S. I see what you mean, but those belong to the same jurisdiction. But now we are talking about different jurisdictions. Why would priority be given? What is the actual progress of the negotiations with mainland? If there is such agreement, why would the agreement with the mainland take priority? So for the wording in the France order, in the future, with the mainland, would some scenarios be crafted out? Article 1 says the requested party can consider different factors in terms of surrender of fugitive offenders to the mainland. Why aren't other factors considered? Why would the SFO agreement with the mainland always take priority? There must be a reason. So what is the reason? So without any SFO agreements with the mainland, would it be too rash to adopt such provision? If not, what is the justification of such? So France is a jurisdiction, so regardless of the severity of the offense, the person requested by a municipality or province would take precedence. So for that case, no surrender is needed. For example, if a fugitive offender is to be extradited to Paris from the south of France, it does not involve extradition. So if the police arrest an offender in Paris and that person is wanted by Lyon, so is that a case of concurrent requests, right? So if both the Paris and Lyon authorities wants the same person, well, that would be a third state. So the example of the domestic case in France might not be the best example. I would address the first point. Currently there are no arrangements with the mainland China, but the commencement period of the order could be very long. So provisions might be added such that if they are required in the future, the agreements would not have to be amended, even though we say that with or without this provision, the treatment would be or the approach would be the same. Mr. Kwok said this is an agreement between jurisdictions. Indeed, it is. But there is the element of one country. So for the first line of the recital, the Hong Kong SAR is authorized by the People's Republic of China in signing this agreement. As for the grounds of refusal, there is consideration on the national defense and security of the mainland. So the chief executive would exercise discretion. So there are some cases not related to national defense and security at all. But the if both the French and mainland governments request extradition, then we are talking about cases that involve extraditions. And these cases do not involve national defense and foreign affairs. Why would the agreement signed with mainland China take precedence? The reason for asking is that there is no current agreement with mainland. Is it really necessary to add this provision? Is there a need to include it at this point? That was my question. When you look at Article 13, Paragraph 3, it does not say that the agreement between Hong Kong and the PRC can take precedence, but that the condition under number 1 do not have to be considered. So it could be a negotiation between Hong Kong, China, and other governments. So for 13.3, if there is an agreement in the future, regardless of circumstances, that agreement would take higher priority than the agreement signed with other jurisdictions. So this is not obvious from what I read. So is that your interpretation? It simply says the provisions shall not affect the arrangements. Let me give an extreme example. So perhaps some you would give way to other jurisdictions. Chairman, the provision says shall not affect. I think a more accurate rendition should be shall prevail over the other arrangements. So that is your so my question was why should it prevail? So the answer was yes. If there's an agreement with the mainland, it would take priority. So the principle is that the any future agreement with the mainland shall take priority, but this is not reflected. The arrangements would not be affected by paragraphs 1 and 2. So if there is an arrangement, or if there is a request for surrender, all things being equal, the mainland agreement would take precedence. So please answer Mr. Kwok's question. So if this reflects your principle, so why are you adopting this principle? So this is the common approach with jurisdiction, with extraditions. Well, I'm not an expert of US law or Australian law as to how they deal with surrender of offenders between different states. I would not rule out the possibility that they might consider the jurisdiction. So within US or Australia, they would deal with their own offenders before they deal with external requests. They operate a Commonwealth jurisdiction. So it does not involve external agreements with other jurisdictions. If the mainland requests surrender of a future offender on a relatively minor offense, while France requests surrender of a serious criminal, then would that person be first sent to the mainland, and after that, well, would there be other provisions like Article 7? There are some conditions saying that when the person must be surrendered.
So I'm just thinking of various scenarios. Say if the mainland wants someone for minor offenses, and France is asking for his surrender for serious offenses, then does that offender has to be extradited to the mainland first? What's the rationale? If it's because of one country, two systems, or is it an obligation on the part of the Hong Kong government? She answered twice, actually, but I think you can actually give us a more detailed reply in writing. Dennis Kwok gave you detailed questions. I was asking about the same thing. So you can reply us back with the reasons. And also, was it that when you did a drafting, the authorities and central authorities already gave you the indication that they should come first? Or did you make reference to other international norms and so forth? Just list them all in the answers, written reply to us. The worst is we don't even have such an arrangement with the mainland, so why are you so sure that PRC should come first? It also should it apply to all cases as well when PRC will come first? Well, let me clarify. It's not about who's coming first, but it's about not affecting the arrangements. But we will give you supplementary information. But this is about competition, right? But if you're talking about not affecting the arrangements, the way it's written, you have to suggest that if all things being equal, then it would not be affected, is it? If say, the person is convicted of murder in both places, then the arrangements will not be affected. Is that what you meant? Or is it that even if the circumstances differ, PRC would come first? So that's the question we had. Several questions raised, indeed. You know about the questions of principle that we asked. So if that's the principle, then whatever it is, then does this provision really reflect that? Okay, so give us a written reply, detailed reply in writing. Okay, so at 4:30, I think some of our colleagues will need to prepare for the 4:30 meeting. I think we can stop here and we'll arrange for another meeting at which you can and then give us a reply, and then you can have time also to prepare for the answers, and we can also call another meeting when needed. So, Secretary, what's your suggestion? January 4th, 8:30, it clashes with other meetings. PAC? Room was booked for PAC, January 7. Let's meet on January 7. I'm sure they will have enough time to prepare the answers. Okay? January 7, we'll meet again. 4:30. Okay, let's mark the date first. Okay, January
7, 4:30. He should be able to, he's so strong.
Thank you. Meeting adjourned.